Well, it's very invigorating to give a talk after a beautiful lecture about the importance of mathematics. And however, I have some doubts about the choice of topics for this talk, because my intention is to talk about some things related to some work I did last year around analytic number theory. And this is a part of mathematics that has a rather bad reputation, maybe deservedly so, because maybe sometimes there are many computations and there is not entirely clear what are the ideas at the conceptual level. So to try to overcompensate this, I will give a talk that where it's mainly based about the ideas and motivation for the questions and practically no detail about what I'm saying. So what I want to focus about is this. One of the main topics of the talk is the distribution of sets in residual classes. So this is one of the most classic topics in number theory. And in case of some of you would not remember, if you have two integers m and n, the reduction of m mod n is the remainder that you get after dividing m by n. Now, this definition does not really do much justice to this concept, which is, as I said, one of the fundamental concepts in number theory. And not only are we interested in how sets are distributed in residual classes, but the fact of knowing how sets are distributed in residual classes tends to give us a lot of information about how the set behaves. So in a lot of applications, you really want to know that your set is well distributed in residual classes, and that allows you to get a lot of beautiful results. To give one outstanding example, one of the big results of last year was Jitong Song's beautiful proof that there are bounded gaps between the prime numbers. Now, the way this result was achieved was actually by showing that the primes are just a little bit better distributed in residual classes than what we already knew. And by known results, this implied that, in fact, there were bounded gaps between primes. So let me tell you what I want to talk about. So first, some simple notation. This is my notation for the first n integers and the corresponding d-dimensional cube. And the question I want to talk about is the following. So as I said, in practice, you many times find yourself in a situation where you want to know that your set is well distributed in residual classes. So we ask the following question. Maybe the case that the only way a set could be very badly distributed in residual classes for many primes p is for the set to have some specific form, to have some specific kind of structure. And this is the general conjecture or a general philosophy that I want to discuss, that in fact, we believe that in many situations, if a set is indeed very badly distributed in residual classes, this is because the set has algebraic structure. Now, I will soon tell you what I mean by algebraic structure. This is a very concrete concept. But besides the nice fact that this problem connects one fundamental concept with this distribution in residual classes with another very simple concept of algebraic structure, it's one of the motivations for this problem, but also the fact that maybe in practice, when you're in a situation when you want to know how your set is distributed in residual classes, then you can in fact either assume that your set behaves as good as you want, or then it has to have a very specific structure, in which case you can use some specific tools for this case. So this is the main motivation for this kind of problem. So let me tell you what I mean by an algebraic structure. So the most basic example of a set that is badly distributed in residual classes is the set of squares. So you take 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, and so on. And it is very well known that this set occupies only p plus 1 over 2 residual classes mod p for every odd prime p. So the squares will occupy only half of the residual classes for every prime p, for every odd prime p. And this is very strange behavior, but the squares do this. Now, whatever algebraic structure means, the squares are certainly a very algebraic set. So this is one example of what I mean by this. In general, this is a particular case of a general phenomenon that the image of a polynomial tends to behave in a weird way in distribution in residual classes. Now, this is a one-dimensional example. If you move to two dimensions, it is much easier to construct examples of sets that are badly distributed. So one very trivial example is the following. You take one set in two dimensions. So in two dimensions, you have p possibilities for the reduction of your element mod p in the first coordinate, p possibilities in the second coordinate. So all in all, your set can occupy p squared residual classes. Now, here is an example. You take the diagonal. So you take all the pairs xy such that x is equal to y. Then, well, once you know what the first class, the first coordinate can be anything mod p, but once you know what the first coordinate is, you know the second coordinate is equal to the first one. So in fact, your set only occupies p residue classes of the possible p squared residue classes. So your set is indeed very badly distributed, and it's a very simple example. But this, you can also write this as the solution set of the equation x minus y equals zero. So this is a particular example of the following general phenomenon, that we know that the solution set of a polynomial equation of low degree always occupies few residue classes for most prime p. Now, how polynomials are distributed in residue classes is another classical topic in number theory. And in fact, very precise estimates are known on how many points does a polynomial has in residue classes. In fact, this follows from the Lang-Weyl estimates. In the case of curves, this is the Riemann hypothesis of finite fields for curves. In general, it's a much weaker consequence. And so this is another general example. And again, this is obviously what I mean by algebra, the solution set of a polynomial equation. So you can construct algebraic sets of, the previous example concerns the degree, the polynomials having very small degree, uniformly bounded. But you can, in fact, construct polynomials of degree like the logarithm of n, like a power of a logarithm of n, that are also badly distributed in residue classes. But in fact, it turns out that you cannot do much worse than this. So, by the way, the branch of analytic number theory that is concerned with the distribution of sets in residue classes is known as sieve theory. And sieve theory already implies that a set that is badly distributed in residue classes cannot be very big. So as I said, you see, sieve theory is a tool that has a lot of applications. And the main motivation for these kind of questions is that, in practice, either you can get much better bounds than what sieve theory already tells you, or then you know that your set is of a very specific form. So let me quickly mention some work on this problem. This things like this phenomenon were already present for many years in the literature, but it was only rather recently that a formal statement of this conjecture was made. This was made around 10 years ago, independently by Kurt and Alschultz and by Helfgott and Benkatesh. But a long time ago, there were also results by Hall and Russia, giving some particular examples of how this phenomenon appears. There's Helfgott and Benkatesh were also able to show this conjecture for the case of dimension equal to 2. There is also work by Chutila, by Borgain, showing that Adam Harper and Ben Green, all these results have to do with the fact that if your set has an additional structure, which is very different from an algebraic structure, then you know that the set has to be very small. So these are all very nice results giving evidence to the conjecture. But now we also have this first general result about this problem that says the following, that in a very general sense, the conjecture is indeed true. So if you have any set with no additional hypothesis that occupies only p to the k residue classes, so you have a set in d-dimensional space, so you have p to the d possible residue classes, and you have a set that occupies only p to the k residue classes for some k strictly less than d, so it is badly distributed, then the only way that this can happen is if the set is indeed the solution set of a polynomial equation of low degree, of degree at most a power of a logarithm. So indeed, this is the only way a set can be so badly distributed in residue classes. So let me say a few words about this. First of all, here I am assuming that this irregularity in distribution holds for every prime p. But in fact, you can assume only that it happens for many primes p. It's just more difficult to state. And as I mentioned, this result is actually optimal. Because as I mentioned before, there are examples of sets that are the solution set of polynomials of degree a power of log n that are badly distributed. But by this result, we know that this is the only way that a set can be badly distributed. Now, the only problem with this result is that, or the main problem with this result, is that even a power of a logarithm is a rather small degree. In many applications, you really want to have a uniform bound on the degree of the polynomial. Of course, there is not much you can do if the result is actually false. But if you place one additional assumption, then you can guarantee this. If you furthermore assume that your set is also big, this guarantees that you can get a polynomial to be bounded by an absolute constant. So these are all just results that may prove to be very useful tools in problems around number theory when you want to know how your set is distributed in residue classes. Okay, so I will skip the formal statement. But what I do want to do some emphasis on is that not only I like this problem because of the reasons I mentioned before, but it happens something slightly strange, that the strategy of the proof of this result falls under the general framework of what is known as the polynomial method. So this I did not know when I did the result, and I found it later, and I'm very interested about this. You see, the polynomial method is nobody really knows what the polynomial method is, but you recognize it when you see it. So this is a kind of idea that has been used in a lot of problems in different areas, and it has a lot of common features. More or less, it's that you study your problem by identifying how do polynomials that vanish on your set behave, or what singularities does a polynomial that vanish on your set has to have. So that's the general properties of the polynomial method, and it turns out to be an extremely useful tool that has appeared in a lot of different areas. So one extreme example of this is the Kakeya problem. So this is a very well-known problem. In particular, there was a toy model for this problem known as the Kakeya problem of finite fields. It was a problem that was worked on by a lot of amazing people, and for many years, using a lot of big machinery, the problem remained open. And then it was solved in only a few pages by Steve Devere using the polynomial method. The polynomial method was not part of the bag of tools of people in this area. And then this guy who came from theoretical computer science, where it was very much used, found a very simple proof of this famous problem. So, as I said, this is a method that appears in theoretical computer science. It appears in problems like the Kakeya problem. It has also appeared recently in combinatorics, in the Erdos distance problem. In fact, the ideas on the Kakeya problem were using algebraic topology were adapted to incidence problem in Euclidean space. So that's another wonderful application. It's a method that appears also in transcendence theory, work of Baker, a long time ago. And it also even appears in analytic number theory. But this method was discovered independently by many people, and so it has different names depending on the context. In analytic number theory, it is known as the Stepanov's method that is used to estimate an exponential sums, and in particular, it is also famously used to give a proof of the Riemann hypothesis of finite fields for curves. So this method appears in many places, and it also appears in this work. So there is a lot of interest in trying to understand what is the correct scope of this method, what this method is all about. Nobody really knows yet. There is a recent survey article by Terence Tao about this. And worst case scenario, this is a very powerful tool that once you can get a good scheme for it, it applies to a lot of different problems. But maybe there is also something else going on at the conceptual level. Because you see, even if all these problems that I mentioned before are from different areas, they have a lot of very interesting connections between themselves, even though they seem very different. So maybe there is something also at the conceptual level that is yet to be discovered that has to do with this polynomial method, and I find that very intriguing. To give an example of what I mean by this, I mentioned the Kakeya problem, and I mentioned Stepanov's method for Riemann hypothesis of finite fields, and these seem two very distinct problems, but a well-known fact that is perhaps not publicized enough is that, in fact, the Kakeya problem follows from Montgomery's exponential pair conjecture in analytic number theory. It's a non-trivial deduction, but it follows from that result. And this conjecture at the same time gives very powerful zero density estimates for the series of L functions and also implies the Lindelof hypothesis for the Riemann set of function. So like that connection, there are a lot of very interesting connections between all these different problems, so maybe there is something to be discovered there yet. So let me mention one other relation in what remains of the talk. So another place where the polynomial method has been applied is in Diophantine geometry. There, it is known as the determinant method. It turns out that the ideas of the inverse sieve problem that I just mentioned before can also be applied to this kind of problems and mix very well with this determinant method. So this is a general approach to counting rational points on curves. So Bessut's theorem is a basic theorem that says if you have two genuinely different curves, then the number of points in which they intersect is at most the product of the degrees of these two curves. And but we already know that curves and varieties in general are badly distributed in residual classes. So by what I said before, this implies that we can build polynomials vanishing on their zeros, on their points. And in fact, these methods are quite flexible, so we can in fact build polynomials that are really different from the original polynomial that defines the curve. So you have a curve defined by a polynomial. It's badly distributed in residual classes. You can use the previous ideas to build another polynomial, different polynomial, that vanishes at all the points that you're interested in. And of course, then the number of points is bounded by the intersection of these two polynomials. So this gives you a very natural approach to the question of the number of points on curves. So let me state the result that I'm talking about. So what question do we care about the number of rational points on curves? So the things I mentioned before are general in the sense that they do not require any hypothesis on your set. So we can try something similar. What is the most general question about the number of points on curves that we can ask without putting any hypothesis? So just pick any reducible curve of degree D, and you can ask how many rational points can such a curve have? How many rational points can in a reducible curve of degree D have? Of course, this is a bad question because it can have infinitely many points, and that's the end of the story. But we always want to quantify this, so the correct way to quantify this is the most natural measure for the size of a rational point. And so we ask the following question: how many rational points of height less than n can an irreducible curve of degree D have? So there are basic examples showing that it can have quite a lot of points. So this is a very simple curve. It is given by the equation x to the d minus y equals 0. And this simple equation has more or less n to the 2 over d rational points of height less than n. This is simply because if you pick any pair of integers a and b of size less than n to the 1 over d, then the pair a over b, a to the d over b to the d, is a solution of this equation. And there are n to the 2 over d such points. So this is a curve having a lot of points. But in fact, nobody has been able to construct a curve having significantly more points than this. And so the conjecture, which is true, is that for every integer g, there exists some constant c that is completely independent of the choice of curve, such that any irreducible curve of degree d can have at most that constant c times n to the 2 over d rational points. So in fact, this example is the worst that can happen for any curve. And it's important to emphasize that this constant is completely uniform over the choice of curve. It does not depend on your specific curve. This bound is valid for any curve that you pick. So the right way usually to phrase these things is in projective space, so where the question is pretty much the same. How many irreducible points of height less than n can lie on an irreducible curve of degree d? Recall that for an integer point x0, x1, xn, written in primitive form, the height of x is simply the maximal size of any of its coefficients. So it's a very natural measure of the size of the point. And so here we ask the same question, which is equivalent to the previous question: how many rational points can an irreducible curve of degree d have? So again, let me quickly mention the work on this problem. This also goes back to the work of Bombieri and Pila in the fine case. This is the first place that the determiner method was introduced to study these kind of questions. Then there was work by Elkish showing this bound for specific families of curves, a very powerful general result of Heath-Brown showing that the conjecture is true up to a small power of n, arbitrary small power of n. There is a work by then Heath-Brown and Browning established the conjecture when the dimension is equal to 2, the case d equals 1 is trivial. Rolled established this conjecture for rational curves with the hypothesis on the discriminant and the determinant of the curve. There is a work by Helfgott and Venkatesh where they use the observation that the higher the genus of your curve is, the less number of points you expect it to have. So they actually prove something even slightly stronger than the conjecture in the case of curves of genus greater than 1. And then there's also a work of Marmon and Broger, and there is the wonderful work by Salberger, where he introduced a global determinant method that is a very powerful tool to study points on varieties, and in particular to give a bound of the form of the conjecture up to a logarithmic factor. But anyway, now this we know this conjecture to be true now. So in fact, for every integer d, there exists some constant completely independent of the choice of the curve, such that there cannot be more than c to times n to the 2 over d points on any curve. So let me finish by mentioning how the proof of what this involves. I mean, this is, as I said, this involves the kind of ideas that I mentioned previously about using the distribution of your set in residue classes. But it also needs to employ, to make this work, you need to employ, I mean, and this is probably a general phenomenon, you need to employ a lot of other machinery. And in this case, make use of Salberger's global determinant method, which is an elaboration of the determinants method of Spombieri, Pila, and Hirschbaum, a lot of beautiful work. Estimates that improving the coefficients, that this was an idea that was used in many works, but in particular in the work of Fallenberg and Benkatesh, and also some estimates by Bombieri and Baller, beautiful result about the number of integer solutions that a general linear equation can have. So this is the last slide, but just for people who are interested in it, so I will not read it for you. So let me conclude by saying that the distribution in residue classes is a nice topic. This may prove a useful tool, but maybe the most interesting thing, as I said, is that this is another example of both how powerful the polynomial method is and about the very intriguing connections that there are between all the different problems involved in this. So I think it's really a very nice problem to try to understand better what the polynomial method really is. Thank you.